Welcome to Success Stories with Shankaraj Academy. Today we have with us Ms. Yashni Nagarajan, who have cleared this year's UPSC Civil Service examination with an All India rank of 57. So first and foremost, hearty congratulations, Yashni, from the entire Shankaraj Academy family.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, Shankar.
And my first question to you is, like, how did you know the result? So were you expecting that result would come, and were you expecting such a good rank? So, and what was your first reaction when you knew the result?
Sir, how I got to know the result is actually an interesting story. So my interview was deferred for the COVID pandemic. So previously it was in March, then it was later scheduled on the last day. Last day as in erstwhile the last day. After that one EWS interview was held, but barring that, my interview was on the last day. So 30th July it was, afternoon session. After that, 3 more days later, my medical examination was scheduled. So my medical examination got over on 3rd of August. And on 4th of August, I was on my flight back home. So my flight took off at around 10:30, and 11 a.m. the results came. So by the time I landed at 2 p.m., everybody knew my results except me. So I was like literally on air in cloud nine when the results came. But and the first reaction was, sir, whether it was expected or not, sir, in UPSC we cannot expect anything, sir. It's like beyond comprehension or expectations. However, sir, we can always aim, we can always set targets and try to achieve that. So I also had in my mind that that target of top 50 I had. Previously, I had secured a rank of 834th in UPSC. So I was this time I have to like make it double digit or under 50. That was the aim. So yes, I tried for that, sir. And reaction, sir. Reaction, first reaction, sir. In my journey, I have seen many ups and downs. So when the moment finally arrived, sir, it was more like a sea of relief and calm, rather than outright ecstasy. One thing that I have realized in this span of my preparation, as my father always says, is to be balanced, not to be too excited when we get success and not to be too depressed to the like bottom when we fail. So other than that, yeah, it feels good, sir.
And how do you feel now, like almost 1.5 months down the result? Has it all sunk in?
Yes, sir. It has sunk in, sir. And now I am in my last week of my present job. I'm presently employed in RBI. So, yes, sir. I'm like just about to resign from this wonderful organization. So it feels good, sir.
Okay. So tell us about your family, Yashni, and their support in the whole UPSC journey.
Sir, my father, my parents, they are both retired government servants. My father was an engineer and my mother was an officer in High Court. And they have always valued education, like they have given it the number one priority. So my father is basically a native of Tamil Nadu and my mother is Nepali from Assam. And I grew up in Arunachal Pradesh. They were posted there. So even like growing up in a remote part of the country, they always made sure that that doesn't hamper our education. The education was like, it was not a compromise, like no compromise on education. So they always tried to make the best facilities available to us. And even in UPSC preparation also, whatever ups and downs, sir, they were always there. They stood firm like as my pillar of support. They were always very encouraging, sir. So kudos to them. And yeah, except yeah, other than that, in my family, I have a brother also, little brother. He is doing management from IIM Indore.
That's great. Support of family is any day important.
Yes.
In this long journey. So
yes, sir.
When did you actually decide that you want to try for civil service? You have done your entire schooling in Arunachal Pradesh. And then you did your BTech again from Arunachal Pradesh. In this education graph, like when did you decide that you want to pursue civil service as a career option?
So, decision to pursue civil service as a career option, it came after graduation only. Until that point, I did not know anything about the exam process, and I did not even know anyone who is in the service or even someone who is into preparation. So the entire thing came after graduation only, sir.
So what motivated you? Was there any inspiration which pulled you to the civil service journey?
Sir, as I mentioned, sir, I grew up in Arunachal Pradesh. So there is one story that is very close to my heart. So when I was being born, my parents were posted in a very remote place. My father is a civil engineer, so into road construction. So very remote place they were posted in. So when I was being born, my mother had to suffer hours in labor pain because there were no medical facilities, like good medical facilities nearby. So the desire to change or desire to do something about that, that was always there at the back of my mind. That's why I always gave like Arunachal Pradesh or Agmat Karo as my first preference. Hopefully I should be getting that. And during this time, and also sir, a lot of civil servants from different parts of the country are doing tremendous work in Arunachal. So, and my father always used to discuss them and their stories, so that also acted as inspiration. Yes, sir.
I'm sure that you will be able to make a lot of changes in the grassroots as you want to do.
I hope so, sir. I hope so. Thank you.
So let's discuss about your preparation journey. So you have given four attempts, you have given three interviews. What kept you motivated through this? This is a long journey. UPSC preparation itself is a long journey. So what kept you motivated and how did you cope with the disappointment? You consistently, you know, failed the interviews, and then how did you cope with the disappointment of this?
Yes, sir. It has been a fairly long journey for me. So my first attempt, I could not clear prelims. I did not think there was any shortcoming on my preparation, but it was more on how I approached the exam, how I reacted in the exam hall. So we'll discuss that later, sir. The first one prelims I did not clear. Then after that, I have given three mains. And all three times I've reached the interview and twice made it to the list. And previously I was allocated railway account service, but I did not join that as I was already employed in RBI back, by that time. So what kept me motivated, sir, is the first thing to keep oneself motivated is it should be internal motivation. Your own inner desire, why are you coming here? What do you want to achieve? And what do you want to do? So that inner motivation is one thing that keeps oneself going. So that kicks in very small things. So like small happiness you can find. If you are self-motivated, you'll find small motivation also. For example, whenever I see official cars passing by, I'll get that pang of motivation. Or just opposite to my RBI quarters, there is the Chief Secretary of Kerala. His home is there. His official quarters is there. So whenever I see that building, again, motivation. So that if you're self-motivated, motivation will find you rather than the other way. And you can also do some bit of reinforcement of motivation. For example, in my summary or on my wall, I used to keep small quotes, motivational quotes, like hard work beats talent when talent does not work hard, or work now, regret later. If you don't work now, regret later, like that. Like these are kind of reinforcement tools so that when we feel low, we recall why are we here in the first place. Apart from that, as I said, my parents, they have also always motivated me. It was my decision, but they stood by it always and motivated. I would suggest others also to surround yourself with positive people. No need of any toxicity in your life or at this point especially. And most important thing, sir, after the initial 1 year, I was employed in RBI also. So having that financial security and having a job, you're already an officer. So that feeling of self-worth is also there. So that also played a big role in motivating, like keeping the motivation going, sir.
So you were actually, after the first attempt, you were working all along while you were preparing, right? So how
yes,
did
sir.
You manage time? How did you manage? And so this would be a question to many aspirants who are working, who want to start the profession, or no, managing the time while you're working. This would be a confusing thought for many aspirants who want to prepare. So what is your take on that? How did you manage time?
Sir, it is very much manageable. UPSC does not have to be a full-time preparation. Like, it's not prudent to, I think, invest years into UPSC preparation, like with keeping your life on hold, going nowhere. So that is not desirable also, in my opinion. So the first prelims that I failed, after that there were two options, either to try for something else or to sit idle for one more year until the next prelims. So instead of sitting idle at home, what I did, I applied for RBI exam. I applied for RBI and one EPF also. I got into both and I picked RBI. So RBI, just after 4 months of failing prelims, I was employed in RBI and I have continued my preparation as a working candidate only. So how I manage time is, so what was the other question, sir? How did I manage time?
Yeah, that's all. Like, you know, many aspirants are confused. Like, those who want to start preparation also. Many people are there who are working now who want to start preparation. Like, you know, weekend batches and all are there. So they're confused whether they'll be able to do justice to their preparation, whether they should quit job and prepare. So you were somebody who prepared all along while working. So how did you manage them? What would be your advice to aspirants who are working currently?
So how I managed time was, RBI, my job was in currency management. So it is a very high security area where I was not allowed any paper or books or whatever, even internet is restricted. So inside that vault, I am there for like good nine hours like that. So all my preparation mostly I did after office hours only. Only the newspaper I tried to finish within office, and that too during breaks, because inside I am not allowed that. So during lunch breaks or tea breaks, during that time only I tried to finish newspaper in office. And most of my preparation was outside office. After office hour every day, I tried to find like 4-5 hours dedicatedly. And on weekends I would extend it to the maximum. And so I could manage it with a reasonable leave also. For example, for mains I got 1 month, 40 days leave I got, and for prelims I got hardly 12 days, and for interview I think a week. So it is very much doable in that. And how to go about it is, make a timetable, make a schedule. Scheduling is very important so that you don't waste the time at your hand. So make a schedule, long-term schedule, short-term schedule, and stick to it. And the most important thing is, sir, to be true to yourself. Even those who are doing full-time preparation also, if you're sitting on the table for 10 hours and not concentrating for 8 hours, that doesn't make any sense. So whatever hours you spend, be efficient. So it is very much manageable with job, or if you are studying also, it is, I think even there are many toppers this year who have been working candidates. So it is very much doable.
Okay. Yes. So let's discuss about something about prelims, but about the prelims preparation strategy. Like, what difference did you do in each of your prelims? You gave 4 prelims. So in the first prelims, you could not clear. So how did you improve yourself in each prelims? And I know that in the second prelims, I guess in 2016 prelims, you were able to score 160 plus in your prelims marks, DS1. So that was a tremendous, huge score. So how did you, improve your preparation for prelims?
Yes, sir. Sir, prelims, the first prelims that I failed, sir, the mistake that I did was my preparation. There was, as I said, there was no flaw in my preparation, if I can say so. But what happened is, during the examination hall, I had not changed my sleep cycle with related to the actual exam timetable. So when I was in the examination hall, while others were like striking their brain hard solving the paper, I was struggling to keep myself awake. And it's funny also now if I think of it. And then I did the mistake of attempting very less questions also. And since my mind was not ready fully, I did those circling mistakes also. So on and all, like very stupidly, I lost that exam. And I missed also by hardly 1.52 marks like that. Hardly like that. So from the next prelims onward, I will discuss later also, sir, in that prelims video. But other than that, I did not do something extraordinary or something. I just focused on multiple revisions and keeping the brain agile, our mind agile, so that like, and even like the realization that we cannot expect to know everything, every question in the prelims. There will be good 30, 40 questions which we might not have any idea to. So how to tackle them and like even elimination also. So these things only. And I think one mistake that I did previous time was I attempted very few questions. I attempted less than 60 questions. So that that I think can be fatal. So attempting at least 85 questions is, it is my personal opinion. Yeah, others may have different view, but it is my personal opinion that at least 85 questions one must try. Yes.
And what about not making for prelims? So you know there are basic books you know you must do for sure, like Lakshmikant, Spectrum, Shankar, and so on. But there are multiple books which is a must read. Like, did you make notes in CRT? Did you make for this book notes for these books? And how did you approach the not making for prelims?
So note making, since I was working candidate, it was either I could read or I could write notes. So note making, I did not do per se. I had marked it. And what I did, what I made summary. So for example, my entire Indian history was in 3 pages. So for quick revision, I did summary, both for prelims and mains. Even for PSIR also, sir, all the important names of scholars and theory, I had like in one sheet, I would make a summary. So I feel more than like trying to enhance our notes, it is more important that we strive to remember whatever we have read. So for that, I did not make notes, but I made summary. And yes, sir. So note making I did not do, but summary I did. And it comes very handy before last minute, before the exam, like just flipping through those pages. Like it acts as a memory booster kind of, you'd remember these important terms just before the examination. So that helps. So note making I did not do.
What about current affairs preparation? How did you prepare current affairs for prelims? Was it from newspapers or were you following monthly compilations? What did you do for prelims current affairs?
So prelims, both prelims and mains, both current affairs, I read one newspaper diligently. It was The Hindu. And one current affair, that booklet compilation, there are many in the available online. So one booklet and one newspaper I did diligently. Other than that, if I have any doubt, any government schemes or summary like economic survey and these things, I did summary from PIB website. And sometimes even PRS website, but these are like only references, not like regular references from there, PIB, PRS, and some selectively debates, selectively, if I want to have an in-depth like idea of, I'm like, if I'm confused about a topic, so I would listen to the debate for the each opposing side to get a clearer idea.
Like debate, like big picture, spot.
Yes, takers. Yes. Big picture, sir. If there is a political person in the debate, out. Please go out. Listen only to the experts. Like, it is important from our point of view.
Yes, yes.
So generally, so, big picture.
Yeah. So like now that prelims is approaching, the you know, the students would be confused whether you should revise the basic books more and more, or whether you should solve more question papers and revise them. So what would be your advice, like? Solving more question papers or revising basic books? What is more important?
So now I think how many days are to prelims? Hardly 10 days. No?
10, 15
so,
days.
Sir, at this point in time, it is my personal opinion that do not go for solving more and more paper. If you have solved paper in the past, revise them, like especially the questions that, where you have made mistakes or questions that you did not know answer to. So those things you revise your basic books, revise your current affairs. At this time, the focus should be on consolidating what you already know, instead of just running behind materials and trying to cover as much as possible. See, there are n number of tests, n number of reading materials in the market. There is no way that one can cover all of them. Like, it's not desirable also. So whatever, like that saying, sir, one bird in hand better than two in the bush. So whatever you know, whatever is the knowledge in your hand, try to consolidate that. So that would be my advice, sir.
Okay. So now let's discuss about the mains. You have given 3 mains. So yes, what sir. Were your strategies for mains and what differences you made in each of your attempting mains?
Sir, in mains, especially this attempt, sir, especially, sir, in all my mains attempt, actually, my GS scores were always good. only this attempt, I'd like to stress on this attempt, what I did, I identified where all my lagging areas are, where all I can improve further. So these areas were optional, ethics and essay. So these I focused most on. So optional, I was not able to score good marks in my previous optional, that is geography. So I took a year break actually, and I changed my optional. Why year break also, you may ask, so because I was not sure of which optional to take. So, and the examination process was weighing down on me a bit also. So I took a year break. I read multiple optionals actually. So this would be my advice to those who are looking to change optional or looking to select an optional, that I was confused between 3 or 4 optionals. So I read socio also, I read anthro also, I read PSIR also. So, and a little bit of economics also. So after reading, I realized that no, this is the subject that I can most align with. So I went with this. So other than that, ethics and essay I worked on this year. So. And as I said, my GS was fine, but even then I did not like take it for granted. I at the end, I brushed it up. So.
Yeah, since you were stressing on ethics and essay, like how did you prepare ethics and essay, and what were your strategies for ethics and essay specifically?
So ethics is one big enigma. Like we can never know what is working or what is not working, and especially now that the marks are not out. So in my previous time, I had got a mere 80 in ethics. So what I did this time was, for example, case studies are there. They are generally around the same theme. There is a tribal who's losing his land, or a needy person on the road needs medical assistance, like, or someone doesn't have enough resources. Like, it is generally broad themes we know. So what I did, I practiced case studies a lot, and I always, beforehand itself, I tried to have these scenarios and what are the possible options could be there ready. Like one, pay from your own pocket, then pros and cons of that. Second, ask the institute to like reimburse, pros and cons of that, ask your seniors, leak to the media, like that. So pros and cons of that. So these things I had ready-made points ready for that. So whatever scenarios I could think of, case study. Similarly for essay also, like again, the broad themes we know, education, women, your cybersecurity or digital literacy or finance, media, again, constitution, democracy. So these broad areas we know. So again, for that 30 minutes, I would brainstorm on each such topic, whatever points come to my mind, and I would try to structure them. So for every topic, I had this structure ready. Like in the real exam, one on healthcare and education was asked. So I already had this structure ready, that in education, I would go like primary, secondary, tertiary, and the problems in that, like that I would go like that. I already had a frame of answer ready. And one important thing that I did in essay was, previously I used to score, this time I don't know, but until now I used to score very average marks in essay. So one big reason for that was that I was very scared of these abstract philosophical types of essays. So I would try to avoid them. So, but this time what I did, this time I tried to tackle them. I practiced philosophical essays also, these random quotes or like I tried to do them also. I referred to Gaurav Agarwal sir's and Kanisha Kataria sir's blog. So basically we just have to expand them on any line, temporal line or sectoral line, economical or political, cultural, like that. We just have to expand it, and I try to practice the same. So in the real examination, when these days, one part of the, like, two sections, section A was almost entirely philosophical. So we should not be scared of that. Rather, we should like try to prepare that beforehand. So this time I prepared, and I was like, I was satisfied with the attempt, like with the essay that I wrote. And yes, sir, for both, I'm sorry, sir. For both ethics and essay, I tried to keep a quote also ready, like random reference of quote. For example, quote related to education, quote related to women, quote related to justice. So I tried, even quote related to terrorism. So former UN secretary had said bullets don't kill terrorists, like, or Malala said bullets don't kill, education does, like that, pen is mightier, like that. So these kind of like sectoral topic based quotes also I kept ready. Like, so that would be my advice also, instead of collecting random quotes, like what we need based on that you collect.
Okay.
Yes.
And how did you prepare current affairs for mains? Was there anything extra you did for main current affairs vis-a-vis prelims current affairs?
So prelims and mains both same source, same type of reading only, sir. The only difference that I did was for prelims, the focus would be more on the fact. For example, if now electoral reforms are being talked about, so which article is it, which committee said what, so that would be the more important thing. However, from the mains perspective, it's the same news, same material only, but you should focus more on what are the pros, what are the cons, what are the way forward. So that was the only difference. The difference is only in the approach, but materials and all are the same.
Okay, so let's discuss about your optional. You have done your graduation, B.Tech in Electrical and Electronics Engineering, but then you picked geography. Initially, geography was your first option. Now moved then into political science. So what was the reason? Why did you pick geography and political science after having a background in Electrical and Electronics Engineering?
Yes, sir. So most of the engineers would agree with me when I say that compared to our engineering subjects, it felt humanities would be much more manageable. So, since we are coming to a generalist job which deals in public, which has public dealings, so I thought again, humanities would be a better option. Why I picked geography was, as I said, sir, that was the mistake I did, if I can say in hindsight. I had no idea about the exam process. Everybody was joining there. My friends were joining that. So I also went along and joined. But later on, so that is why it's very important to identify what you want to like study in depth. For that, if you want to continue with your graduation subject, or you have a literature subject or something, a subject of your interest in mind, then go ahead with that. But if you have doubt in your mind, then my advice would be, first, if you have doubt in the humanities subject, first advice would be you read the GS. When we read the GS, then we'll get to know towards which subject we have a bent of mind. Then after that, then if you are unsure, then you look at previous year's question paper or the NCERTs or little notes, and then you decide, make an informed decision, because it has to be like your optional has to be your best defense. That is my advice. Because, sir, in general studies, studies, sir, the mark difference is not much. Marks difference is not much. Generally, everyone scores around the same only. But in optional, it is that makes the greatest difference.
So, like, you said you switched from geography to PSIR. So there would be aspirants who are currently preparing with geography. They would also be eager to know, like, why did you switch from geography and whether they should also switch from geography, etc. So what is your take on that? Why did you make this switch?
So first thing why I switched was, one, that it was not an informed decision. So I felt like I am liking this subject more, other subject. And second thing was that I was not scoring. I never crossed 250. That actually should be the first reason. So historical reason aside, the most important reason was that I was not scoring. So two mains with geography, I'm not able to score more than 250. And last mains, like while others were scoring 330, I was unable to cross 250. And my GS marks were always good, sir. Always over 400, 420 GS marks. But optional mark, like I was not getting anywhere with that. So previous time when I saw 96 marks in paper one geography, so that is the time when I decided that I am definitely going to make the switch. So if others are also with the subject, only because I changed, it's not like a recommendation that you should also. There are many candidates this year also who have cracked with geography. Every year there are students cracking with geography. Last year also I think someone scored 300 plus, but I could not do it. So try to identify your strengths and your weaknesses, and then only decide on future course of action.
Okay, so now that you have cleared with PSIR, political science, so what all will be your advisors to people who are preparing with PSIR, the do's and don'ts of PSIR optional?
So PSIR, this was my first time with PSIR, and with the I'm definitely I'm sure that PSIR has made a mark, but in absence of breakup of marks, I'm not sure what to advise actually. But what I have done is I have tried to keep my source minimal. I had only a couple of notes, and that only I revised thoroughly, and whatever test series question banks answers, that I revised thoroughly. So main thing I I'm so sorry for the disturbance. Yeah. So main thing I did was minimal notes and multiple revisions, and try to make interlinkages. For example, in PSIR, first paper is generally Western thinkers, and second paper, first section is generally Western thinkers. Second section is Indian thinkers. So if we are talking about Kautilya, then we can say that Jawaharlal Nehru had said that he is a modern Indian Machiavelli, like that. So trying to make interlinkages like that. Or if we are learning a theory on international affairs, so the same when we are writing international affairs answers, so quoting that theory. Or for example, there are many renowned writers who write on subjects, so quoting their name. So it adds substance to your argument that, see, I am only not saying that, this fellow has also said. For example, Guha, Ramchandra Guha is there, he writes. And you, so one thing that I did was I used current affair knowledge extensively in this. For example, just before mains, Prime Minister Modi had gone to Russia. He had announced a new line of credit to Russia's Far East. So if you are writing Act East policy, so we can always write that Act East is now not only limited to our immediate neighborhood, but we are reaching even up to Far East, Russian Far East, or like their statements, like Prime Minister Modi's statements or Defense Minister statement, Foreign Minister statement. Those are used extensively, and certain thinkers like Raja Mohan or Shyam Saran, their articles keep coming in the newspaper. It's not like no rocket science. We are all reading it. So their arguments. And even some interesting things also you can add. For example, Yogendra Yadav had written an article, Why Congress Should Die, or Jeffrelot writes a lot on India's right wing. So these things I quoted. Ramchandra Guha had written on the issue of left in India, left politics in India. He had written that how they should rebrand themselves as socialist and then revamp themselves. So these ideas are there. So those things also I used extensively in my answer. So it looks interesting also. You're not just sticking to the theoretics, because PSIR is a very dynamic subject. So yes, sir. So current affairs, I substantiated like my arguments with, and statements of these people.
Okay. So let's discuss about your interview. Like, you have given three UPSC interviews. So how was the experience? So the last one was a COVID interview. You gave the interview amidst COVID. So how was this interview experience? How was the total UPSC experience, interview experience, all your attempts?
So interview experience, actually every interview was different only. Questions were also like mostly situational. So interview experience, but one thing I've realized is that with every interview, I have evolved as a more mature or stronger or wiser person. And this was a COVID interview also. And yeah, every time I got fair marks only. And this was a COVID interview. So this was very different, as in like with full shield, mask, gloves, and panel was also seated afar. Initially, I was like clinging to the edge of my chair and shouting literally. Then finally, we settled on moderate voice modulation, because they were very far away. So I also did not realize how much like my volume should be. But other than that, every interview experience was different, sir. Generally, Generally, so for example, some commonalities are there. Some points in my DAS that strike out, like my geographical exposure, Arunachal Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, and then now presently working in RBI Trivandrum. So these comparison questions, cultural or these things, these are kind of the expected questions for me. But other than that, many questions are situational. For example, once Basi sir had asked me, that time I was geography optional also, what would happen if we tilt the axis, Earth's axis 180 degree, or those kind of questions. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So this year, did you get any interesting questions? Because it was a COVID interview also. Which board did you get this year? And any interesting questions this year which you got in the interview, actual interview?
Sir, this year I got Bharat Bhushan sir's board. An interesting question. It was mostly related to my job in RBI. In wake of COVID, central bank's roles have become more enhanced also, and how going forward the COVID pandemic will change the world. Mostly related to that and international affairs. I'm sorry,
yeah.
Sir.
No, it's no issues.
So, the other question was that any interesting question that I got?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. So, one question. So, going forward, this time I was sufficiently confident, sir. So, one question Bhushan sir had asked that this is a pandemic time. This is a post-pandemic era. So, going forward, what do you think will define global partnerships? So I said, sir, first thing, economic resilience will define global partnerships, right? So for example, now China's economy has rebound. So that is most strong, economically more strong. So it would flex its muscle politically also and militarily also. Then he said that, don't you think technological availability will also play a role in forging partnerships? So I said that, sir, I would like to humbly disagree there. I think that technological partnerships will be an event of, or as a post facto thing. Like it would be a result of partnership, not the decider of partnerships, because even if a country has technology, trust is necessary. First, trust should be there. That would lead to partnership. And only as a result of that, we would be trusting in their technology. If we trust in their technology, then only we'll be imbibing it. For example, take the case of Huawei. No, although it is the best placed to implement 5G at the moment, but because trust is missing, so based on that, technological partnerships is not happening. So that I felt that then after that, Bhushan sir also, he commended that yes, that is an important aspect, that to have technological partnership, first we should have the trust like that. So I feel if you are logical and if you can give your correct reasoning, you can confidently put forth your view also in front of the board. And one more interesting question I was asked was, like, since I have so many geographical exposure, I was asked this question, how many languages I know like that. So this was asked in RBI also. So I know English, Hindi, Nepali, Assamese, and Bengali. I can understand Tamil moderately, and Malayalam I have been in relentless pursuit to learn that, but Malayalam has so far not been my cup of tea because I keep mixing Malayalam with Tamil and it has gone haywire. So that is an interesting question, sir.
Okay, so this interview experience, which you shared with us itself, show the expertise and maturity you have shown in the interview, which would have definitely reflected in the marks also. I guess marks are yet to come.
I hope so, sir.
Yeah. So now a few general things. Retrospectively thinking, what were the three mistakes you feel you have done during the preparation? Because it took almost four attempts. So what were the mistakes you committed that was acting as a hindrance in clearing the exam, civil service exam?
So first thing was picking optional correctly. And that would be my only regret also, that I took too long to rectify it. every time I was reaching the interview stage and I thought to continue with that only, I could not muster the courage to study, to start afresh. So first advice would be, if you think you can do better with a midterm correction, go for it. Do not think that it is not possible. Nothing is impossible if you are resolved. Then second thing would be, sir, revision and practice. Revision and practice are very important, like especially answer writing practice. We get to know our flaws beforehand and we can work on it. And third thing would be wasting time, sir. Just after when I joined the job, just the first attempt after that, I could not manage time. That was the peak of demonetization time also, and I used to be in office till at least 10 p.m., 11 p.m. like that. But even then, I could have worked better. I could not manage time. So that is an important point, that whatever time you have at hand, try to make the best use of it. The time will never be perfect. We cannot just keep waiting for it. Rather, we should try to make perfect whatever we have. Try to strive for that. Yes, sir. So
great experiences, life experiences.
Yes, sir. We cannot just stop and keep waiting for the right time. That would be the key thing.
True that. Now, like, how did you manage stress? Like, were you stressed in this long journey of UPSC? And if at all you were stressed, how did you manage stress? Like, were you having hobbies before UPSC? Could you continue with these hobbies while you were preparing? And no, did you use social media and all while you were preparing for UPSC? So how did you manage stress in the preparation?
Yes, sir. So stress is very natural, sir. I think if it is not there, then there is something wrong. You should, like, even if I'm not able to achieve a target or something, that stress, moderate stress, should be there. It keeps us like abreast and awake. So yes, how did I manage stress? So one thing is that, again, I kept myself engaged. Being in work, I did not have the luxury of time to waste. So keeping engaged did like empty mind devil's workshop. So that part was taken care of. I had only 4-5 hours to prepare, so that I prepared well. Other than that, yes, I kept my hobbies also going. Not regularly, but whenever I could. Driving is my hobby. Traveling is my hobby. Like swimming. So whenever I got time, whenever I felt like there is a need to unwind, I did. And once, as I said, sir, the attempt in which I could not score anything, in which I could not get any service, I could not make it to the list. After that, I took a year break. I felt that this continuous process is getting too much for me. So I took a year break and I again explored all the other optionals that I have. When the mark sheet came, I saw 96 only in paper one. So after that, I explored all the other optionals I have. I took a break. I went traveling also. So now that I was earning, again, these things were taken care of. That additional worry was not there. So yes, sir, pursuing hobby to unwind. And again, my parents. And more than that, sir, that resolve was there, that only this much in paper one and I am having good marks here. So there was no resounding, no thought of quitting, but how I can like improve. I knew where all I can work upon. So that only I strive to like fix them.
So it's all about the determination and perseverance. It will pull you. Yeah. And what about social media? Were you using social media? So there is this notion that you should stay away from social media, but using social media could be a different school of thought. So what is your take?
Sir, social media, Facebook and WhatsApp, I was not there since at least, I don't remember, two and a half years. I was not there. These are unnecessary information, sir. Unnecessary information overload. Who is doing what, getting what job, going where. These unnecessarily add to our burden only. Like we are studying here and someone is roaming around somewhere. Human psychology, we will be affected. So it's best to keep away from these things. Other things like other social media, like for example, Telegram. Telegram is very good tool, I found. We can meet like there are groups of study groups are there. There are channels, institute channels are there. Lot of resources and materials are there. So Telegram is the only social media that I used. And sometimes Instagram, and that too, I had a timer. Like these apps, free apps you can download that minimizes your time spent on each app. Because internet phone I was using extensively for internet. So I could not afford to waste time on these social media sites for searches and all those things. Phone, Google was a good companion. And other than that, yes, sir. Yes, sir. So social media is much only.
Away from social media during your research. Except Telegram.
Yes, sir, I was mostly. Except Telegram, yes, sir.
Okay. And now let's discuss a bit about your RBI experience also. You have been working in RBI for almost 4 to 5 years now. So how is your whole RBI experience and what all will be your tip to aspirants who are preparing for RBI also?
Sir, RBI is a wonderful, wonderful job. Like it's a wonderful organization. It nurtures talent. Like it, there are a lot of training opportunities like RBI provides for even in India or in foreign, like every month I'll be having some training like that. And even RBI has, as we know, as a central bank, it has a very diverse, it's RBI's role is very wide. It has from currency management to banking supervision to forex dealings, even India's agent in the IMF. So since RBI's role is very wide, the exposure that RBI gets is also very diverse. So it is a very good option, like even deputation to World Bank is also there. So it is a very good option. And what I did was, as I said, I gave RBI exam just 1 month after the result of prelims came. So whatever I knew, whatever I had read for civil service, that came in very handy. So this should be true for all the civil service aspirants out there. That came in very handy. And one more thing I did was I did previous year's paper practice of RBI question paper. So my advice to RBI, those who are aspiring for RBI would be, like, one thing, do previous year's question paper. Second thing, whatever economy or banking related you have learned for civil service, that would help. But focus more on the theoretical part. RBI questions have some reference to theory and curves and those things. At least that time it was. And third thing would be newspaper. Newspaper reading is very important. And focus more on economic and banking news also. I think in some free websites also, they give banking and finance news separately. So you can follow that. And fourth thing would be one paper is there, this paper. English paper. It requires typing also, keyboard typing. That time it was there, but I'm not sure about the exam process now. That time one English paper was also there. So for that, Prezi writing and essay writing, you can practice and practice on the keyboard if that exam is still there. So these are the things I did. And RBI is a wonderful career and it encourages you in whatever endeavor you pick.
Okay, that's great. So, what would be your advice to, the new aspirants who are about to prepare or about to start preparation or just started preparing, and as a senior aspirant who cleared after multiple attempts, so those aspirants who are continuously trying and, they're not able to clear the exam. So, what would be your advice to these two categories?
Sir, for the first category, actually for both the category, first thing would be to identify your purpose. Why are you coming into this field? What is it that you wish to achieve? So first thing would be finding your purpose. Second thing would be then those who are not able to do, or those who are, see, even when we started preparation, it was like, okay, we'll finish it in 1 year and like that. But it might not always happen like as you wish it to be, right? So be prepared for any exigency and don't listen to anyone who says that you cannot do it. Very normal people are clearing and I can clear, you can also clear. So do not listen to anyone who says that you cannot do it. You know if you can do it or not, and you know what you must do for achieving it. Secondly, if you are repeating the exam, so most important thing for you would be, one, not to lose hope, and next would be to identify your mistakes and work on them. It doesn't make any sense to keep repeating the same mistakes and expect different results. So identify your mistakes, work on them, and then start fresh, like with a fresh bent of mind. There is nothing that you cannot do if you are determined to. If you are determined, you can do anything. Yes, sir, that would be my advice.
That's a great advice, which everybody can, you know, follow meticulously in this preparation journey. So Shankaraj Academy is really happy that we could also be a part of your preparation journey and the success journey. So it would be great if you can share some of your experiences with Shankaraj Academy.
Sir, with Shankar, I took interview guidance program, sir, in this attempt also. And in my previous, when I was previously going to interview also, that time also I took interview guidance and mock interviews. So mock interviews do help, sir. It did help. Maybe if not questions, if not all the same also, but it helps you prepare, like how to present yourself and how to, like, how to answer the question. Like, it doesn't, not like what you should answer, but how you should answer. So that way, mock interviews and the interview guidance program was very helpful. I gave one mock interview with Shankar sir also. I had given one with Shankar sir also. And Rajita madam also, I was taking guidance from. Yes.
And thank you.
Trivandrum Center also. Yes, yeah. In Trivandrum Center also. They were always ready to help.
So we are happy that again we could provide you with some assistance in this journey. So thank you so much, Yashni. Once again, all the very best. Let you be able to serve the nation to the best of your abilities. And I'm sure that you're going to make many changes at grassroots level. Let you be an inspiring IAS officer. All the very best. And thank you so much for spending time with us.
Thank you so much for your kind words, sir. I hope I can do something. I hope it would be for the best or for the betterment of at least if one person, if it helps, I would be very, very satisfied. So I'm very thankful for your kind wishes, sir. And thank you, Shankar IAS, for guiding me, for being a part of the journey.
Thank you.